Okay, and what we are doing, there's some equation boundary transfer. I haven't shown you about how do we actually use it yet. Okay. We will go through it today. Today we will talk about Langhinter mode and try to finish the erosional velocity and the hydrate inhibitor. Okay, hydrate inhibitor, how much do we add? I want you to recall that this kind of graph. You remember this? That we calculate the enthalpy difference. We will, this will be on the exam for sure. That's the only one thing to test you, okay? All right, last time we end at this slide, when we talk about how do we read the log scale. This important, but not that much important, okay? So when you do the reading, you see something between this and this, 3 to 4, and it's not in the middle, you may say, okay, 3.3 or something. If you want it more accurate, do it this way, okay? But in the exam, okay, if it is on the log scale and you have something in the middle, you cannot say 5. You have to say 3 or 3.1. Okay. And log scale, if it is in the middle, it is not, you see, from this point, that's 10, right? And that's 100. In the middle, it's not 5, it's 3.16. Good? Okay. That's the purpose of this one. So we do this calculation to find out how much is the pressure drop in the coil. And the equation is just this equation. And what we get from the chart is P1 squared minus P2 squared. Okay, that is what from the chart. We do the chart reading. The chart looks like this. Okay, chapter 2, figure 5. We have to know flow rate, okay? MMCFD, million standard cubic foot per day. So we have 3 million standard cubic foot per day. And I read the pressure drop factor for each pipe. 1 inch, 2.5, 2 inch, okay? And for a bigger pipe, I have for 3 inch, XX, 2 inch, standard size, 2 inch X, okay? And I show you the summary, what happened after I do the reading. So basically what we read is just P1 squared minus P2 squared. In the exam, you read starting from the smallest one. And you don't need to do this many, this too many, okay? But I show you, okay, for 3 million standard cubic foot per day, if I have 1 inch X heavy, so I get P1 squared minus P2 squared equal to 300,000 something. Okay. For 2.5 inch is 50,000. 2 inch XS is 30,000. 2 inch X is 8,000. Okay.
That's minimum?
Minimum? Just P1 squared minus P2 squared. It is a factor to be used in this equation. And the unit has to be PSIA for P1, PSIA for P2, and LV. So we just get one part of the equation. Okay. What we are trying to do is to get pressure drop in the Langhinter. Langhinter, to get the pressure drop. So we get this, just this term come from the reading, okay, figure 5. Okay, the next step is P1 squared. How do we do P1 squared? P1 squared is given, right? P1 squared, I have, we don't actually get P1 squared. Let's follow this. So first step, read the chart, get P1 squared minus P2 squared. Then We have to get equivalent length L sub E. Okay? Equivalent length is the last term in our pressure drop equation, L sub E divided by 100. You see that? And L sub E has to be in the unit of feet. How do I get that? I use a table. I look up the table. So table 5. Table 5 look like that. That is table 5. Okay. The first column from the right side is the equivalent length of pipe for pressure drop calculation in feet. Just take that number. How easy it is? Very easy, right? Okay, so I see the tube size of 1x, 1 inch x is 93. Okay, I take that 93, put back into the equation that I have earlier, put it there. Almost done. Okay, not done yet. The calculation that I have is, I copy your value, okay? 1 inch is 93 feet. 2 inch, x and xx, and there are several values for equivalent length. It's not just one value. If you look at the chart, so for 2 inch x or xx, it depends on size of the line heater. So if it's 6 feet, 10 feet, okay, another 10 feet but bigger diameter, you see this, sometimes it's 68, sometimes it's 100 or 177. So equivalent length represents the length for, I think for 2 inch in the X or something is equal to 100. So if you have the pressure drop in a small pipe, and we have the pressure drop in the big pipe, the pipe diameter is not the same, right? Sometimes you see the coil area. So in different line heater, it have different actual length of the coil inside, right? The coil inside is not the same. How do we compare them together? We cannot directly compare. So the book give us the equivalent length, so that is comparable between one model to another model. Okay, so for now, just know that equivalent length can be used to compare from one model to another model. Just that. Okay, so I have P1, inlet pressure 3000 psig or 3014.7 psia. I put the value back there. So P1 square is 3014 square minus this value read from the chart, right? And LE come from the table. Everything to the power of 0.5, or take the square root, and I can get P2. And pressure drop is P1 minus P2. Put everything in the equation. Then I calculate delta P for different cases. Okay, delta P for different cases. You see that if we use 1x case, okay, small pipe, and I have equivalent length of 93, I calculate dp, I get 52. 52 is more than the suggested value of Seawald textbook. They suggest like 5 to 20 is okay, and in this example, we try to find the pipe size that have the pressure drop, which is less than or equal to 20 psi. Okay, so just substitute the value, do several cases, then I find, okay, if I use 1x, equivalent length of that or that, either of that, it is more than 20 psi. So pressure drop is too much for 1 inch. Then I use 2.5 inch, that equivalent length and that equivalent length, 68.3 or 229.3. Pressure drop is 5.6 to 19. So 2.5 XXX, it is okay. Right? Then I check two double X. I have pressure drop from 3 to 11, so it is okay. So everything else is okay. The one that is too small is 1X. Okay, so if we consider just the pressure drop, or just the pressure, not the heat transfer, we will select the smallest pipe and the thinnest pipe that can withstand the pressure and have pressure drop less than 20 psi. Just that, okay? Next thing that you want to know is X is thicker than standard, and XX is thicker than X, and there are triple X is thicker than double X. Just that. Easy, right? Say easy, very easy. So in this case, 2X size is the smallest size that work. Okay. Early on, we delete 2X standard, which is schedule 40. So standard is 40, X is 80, XX is 116. So we delete 2-inch because our criteria is the working pressure has to be 3,000. So maximum pressure that it can withstand is less than 3,000. So we delete this, right? 2X. We cannot use. And 1-inch X, we cannot use because the pressure drop is too high. So the next size up is 2-inch X. And we select that. Done. Just read the chart. So realize that when I do this, I use Excel. Read chart several times and just put the number in, get the result quick. You cannot do it quick in the exam, right? You don't have, you have just calculate, one calculator that cannot do much. So what you will do is, you want to check 1-inch. Probably it will be too small. And you show that, okay, 1-inch is too small, and the pressure drop is 50, so it's more than 20 psi. We don't use it. And then you check the next size up. Next size up is actually 2X, right? Standard, we don't even need to check, because we delete it early on. You remember the pressure is less than the maximum pressure. The maximum pressure is less than the given pressure, so we delete it. Clear enough. Martin Ausenbrook. Martin, is this clear enough?
Clear enough.
Do Martin, why do we want to know any of these? What's the purpose?
Oh, I just teach you and you just study. Why do we need to know this? What's the reason?
Pick the right equipment.
Pick the right equipment, yes. And it is important question, right? It could be several thousand dollars question. And you don't need to do much. You just spend
10 minutes and you answer what? Several thousand dollars? Yes, question.
The question says you want to have a pressure drop less than or equal to 20 psi. Where does that number come from?
That number comes from the recommendation from Siwa's textbook. And if we think about it, so if we have the inlet pressure of 30, pressure drop of 20 will be too much, right? But typically we have the inlet pressure of like 1,000. Pressure drop of 20 out of 1,000 will be just a little bit, so it doesn't matter. So that's the recommendation. Of course, if you use too big, like 50, maybe that's not going to be a big deal if you have enough pressure. But when we choke it too much, the reservoir flow less. Correct? Okay, I want to correct something for the heat transfer. Next thing, we will do the whole calculation that previously we studied about log mean temperature, right? We studied about how to read the U value, and I didn't tell you how to use it yet. This time, in this example, I will show you how to use it. One thing that I want to correct what I said last time is in the water bath, water in the bath doesn't move, okay? Right? It's just water in the bath for the light heater. sit outside, it doesn't move. So if it moves, your value will be higher. Okay, but it doesn't move, so that's your value that you get. It is for the case where water doesn't move. Do we have any actual movement of water in the water bath of the line heater? Yes. Okay, because water is hot, right? Away from the pipe is hot. Close to the pipe is cool. So there's a different density. Therefore, there will be some natural convection, movement due to the difference in the density. So there is a movement, but there is no like fan or anything to move water around our pump. So that's the value that you get. Okay, next example will conclude everything. Okay, this part, you see that if we know just the pipe size, it is not enough to select the model, right? When we want to get a quotation, we may need to say, I want 30 inch by 6 feet, or I want 30 inch by 10 feet, or this one, which one do I want? So that model, 30 inch by 10 feet, has a 2 inch X. Okay? Another model also have 2 inch X. Another model also have 2 inch X. Several models has the same coil size, pipe size inside. So if we just know the pipe size, it is not enough. We have to know more. So we have to know firebox rating. Okay? To buy it, we have to specify firebox rating. We have to specify the tube size, and we check the coil area, and then it's done. Okay. So let's do the example. This is an example one in the Silver's textbooks. We have part of it done already, and I will review briefly. So the given information is gas flow rate of 3 million standard cubic foot per day. That sound familiar? Yes, we use that in every example. Specific gravity of gas is 0.7. Okay. Inlet flowing pressure is 200 psig. I think it should be 2000, that's a typo. Line pressure is 750 psig. Variation in pressure is 3000 psig. Okay. So we did first part of this example already. Okay. First part of this example is based on this information, how much is BTU per hour? Do you remember? Okay. So as that previously from figure one, heat requirement is 300,000. Do you remember 300,000? How do we get that? So let's go back a little bit. From the example that we use in this chart. So there's a typo, please do the correction, but the inlet pressure is, flowing pressure is 2000, not 200, okay? So when we have the fluid coming at 2000, we assume the fluid come at the 100 temperature, and we heat it up, and then we choke it, so that after the choke, it is still at another 100 temperature. So that will tell us the minimum amount of heat required for gas to not form 100. Or just about to form 100. You remember this example? After we get BTU per power mole, we do some trick to convert from BTU per power mole to be BTU per hour. There are one way of doing it is to do direct calculation, use PV equal to NRT, and know that one power mole is 300 something cubic foot. Okay, and change power mole to cubic foot, and then based on the flow rate that we did earlier, then we know that okay, from 900 BTU per power mole multiplied by something power mole hour, then we get 300,000 BTU per hour. We did that. You still remember? This week we have already post the homework, and you have seen that I post the homework. It's just read something and do the summary of 200 words. Very small amount of work because you already have the field trip. So this week homework is doesn't take much time. It's very easy to do. So it's a reduced amount. And hopefully you will be able to be ready for the Tuesday. I think it should be on Tuesday. Either Tuesday or Thursday, I will try to give you a quiz. You like it? Okay. I try to give you a quiz. Either Tuesday or Thursday. So we did already for the case where 300,000 3 million static to be fit per day and gamma equal to 0.7, the temperature come in at hydrate formation temperature, we heat it up and choke it. So that's required a heat of 300,000 BTU per hour. Good? That's required 300,000 BTU per hour. How about U value? I put it here that is equal to 94 as done previously. Do you still remember? What is previously? Did I do any of that? Martin? You remember Martin?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. When did we do 94? Okay, let's go back a little bit. 94. That is the U value. Martin, where does that come from? Is that from the chart or direct calculation?
Chart.
Chart, okay, yes. You see, go up from 3 million standard cubic foot per day with the point where it is, or that is for 2-inch X, you see. 2-inch STD standard X heavy. So that dashed line is for 2-inch X heavy. And from within the chart, we found the U value. One thing that you need to know for this coming quiz is the unit of U value in SI and in the field unit. Okay, BTU per hour per square feet Fahrenheit. And watt per meter square per Kelvin. Just that, you know how to convert from SI to that, right? What is the unit for overall heat transfer coefficient? Of course, you should be able to tell because I tell you the question right now. Unless I forget the question and I share something else. Okay, I'll be sorry for that. So, you remember from reading the chart, if we had 300,000, not 300,000, 3 million static cubic foot per day, for the case of 2-inch X, we have the BTU per hour, we have the U value of 94. That's come from reading the chart. Some people make it 90. Some people make it 91, 92, 93. It doesn't matter, okay? At the end, the answer is almost the same, just like the same thing, okay? So, all right, 94, Martin, told us that it is from the chart, and he said, yeah, it's from the chart. We know where it is, right? So, next step, assume water bath temperature of 180. Where does that 180 come from? Recommendation from Siwa's textbook. Can we use water bath temperature of 130? 160? 140? You probably don't know, but you know for sure that we try to heat it to what temperature? So let's go back. We try to heat it from about 71 to 125. First step is to heat gas from 71 to 175 or 125. If we use water bath of 125, it won't heat it to 125, right? So you have to use something that is hotter than 125. How hot? You just guess and then check if what you guess match with the core area that they provide and you value or not. Okay, that is the actual step. To get the right guess, just 180. Good? So just 180. You can use 190, 181, 182, 183. you may use 200, but too high temperature, oh, it will almost boil, right? And it have too much vapor come out, and you may have to add glycol to heat the temperature up higher than what you can with just water. And you don't want to do 212. Martin, what happened at 212 Fahrenheit? Something boil or something? Is that the boiling point? Yes. Martin said yes, so we believe him, okay? So 212 is going to boil. Change the phase, vapor come out, and it's kind of expand. If you, we are in a confined space, when it expand, it doesn't have room to expand, it's do what? Explode. So 180 is a recommended value, okay? If you want to use 181, 182, 183, or 179, something, state your assumption, okay? So they assume that water bath temperature is 180. Okay, in test, if you assume something else, that your assumption. So then use figure 4 or do the direct calculation. Where's the figure 4? Figure 4 look like that, I think. And you don't need to use figure 4. I already told you the formula, right? So instead of use figure 4, let's use a formula. I think it is easy. Okay. This is to calculate log mean temperature difference, T sub m, or delta T sub m. Okay. To calculate log mean temperature difference, you see TH1 minus TC1 minus TH1 minus TC2 or something. You remember that equation? We substitute the value in. Let's check the equation one more time. So TH1 minus TC1 minus TH2 minus TC2, okay, divided by the ratio of that. Good, that is the equation. So let's see how I substitute the value. TH1 minus TC1, TH1 is a hot side is 180. TC1 is inlet, so we say, okay, gas enter at 71. So that is TC1. And TH2, so water bath temperature is the same everywhere, so it's 180, minus TC2. TC2 is outlet. Outlet is 125. Put 125 in, and the ratio of that, I get 78.95. Okay.
What
value is the answer for locking the temperature?
Okay, let's move on.
We can also use the chart. Is like that. So I did not show you the example for using the chart for that particular example, but just believe me that when we use a chart, the reading is the same. Okay, and I will show you more later. So use the chart, you will have to calculate GTD, greater temperature difference, and then you have to calculate LTD, least temperature difference, and from least temperature difference and greater temperature difference, wherever the cross is, then you read the number, then you get the log mean temperature. Maybe that's easier for you. You can use it again, but the answer should be close. Okay. Or you, if you finish, you can use another method to check your answer. Okay. All right. Next step, calculate the coil area. Okay. Coil area is Q over U and log mean temperature difference, T sub M. Q is 200,000 calculated earlier. U is 94, read from the chart. T sub M is about 80. You can get from the chart or from here, from the formula. the same. So A is about 40 square foot. 40 square foot. And I do the reading too, and the reading from the chart is about 80 Fahrenheit too, if you want to read log-in temperature from the chart. So we get area 40, and we did the pressure drop calculation check, right? We check the pressure drop. We know that it has to be 2x. 1 inch x is too small. Okay, so first thing we look at the firebox rating, BTU per hour. 1000 is what this unit can give us, but we need 100,000. We need 300,000, right? So 100 is not enough. 250 is not enough. 500,000 should be enough, right? So then we look at this model further. Okay, look at tube size. Do you select 2-inch X or 2-inch XX? How do you know that? You check the pressure drop, right? So in the exam, you not just select this model, you have to tell, I want this one, 2-inch X or something, okay? And then coil area. This unit provides us about 50 square feet for the coil area, but the required coil area is just 40. But this thing gives us 50, so it is enough, right? It is enough. Let's say you want to operate at the temperature lower than 180. Okay? You want to operate lower than 180. If you use something less than 180, your log-in temperature will be less than 80. Okay, less than 80. And look at this. So Tm, instead of 80, it will be less than 80, right? So if you have a, you operate just 150 something, Tm may be just 30. And this increase the area. So if 80, this number go down, the result for area will go up, right? When it go up, it show that, okay, it's too much. So if the result number of A is more than the provided coil area, so this means we did not use something that is hot enough. If we use hot enough water, we don't need that kind of temperature. Okay? So after we assume 180, of course, we can check if the coil area match to what is available in the market or not. Just that. And we should, if we use less, let's say we use the coil, the water bath temperature is 130, the coil, the temperature difference may be just 5, and this increase a lot, and none of the unit can do you any good. Okay, so we can recheck if the water temperature that we use is enough or not. Done. You may not believe it, but we just have this kind of thing on the exam one on 2015 and 16. Many people might not do it because they did not attend the class. So on average, your senior missed 5 times, okay, for the whole semester. One person missed 14. Okay. Some people miss like 6, 7. 5 is like normal. 6 is very normal. So, but you come every time, so you should get better grade. Okay? All right, more example. This time, I will show you what is the difference between split and not split or something. So, see this? This is in your textbook too, Siwa's textbook. How does it look like? Did anyone download it? Probably not yet. It looks like this. Chapter 2. Okay. And it is many pages. Many pages. Okay. And have several charts. Do you print it? No. I give it to you during the exam. The reason is you have to draw something on it and submit it too. Okay. So like this, you may have to draw, you heat from what temperature to what temperature, and you submit that, right? So you may want to print it for your review, but for the exam, there's no excuse that I didn't print it out or something and you cannot do the exam like your senior used before. Because this time I print it, and if you cannot do it, it's not my fault. Okay, there are several sharp. This is sharp 3. This is for U value, right? This is for U value. Okay. And the sharp 4, this is a log mean temperature. So this one is log mean temperature. And the example that we talk about, okay, and this is a table called pressure rating. Okay. Several things. So you can check on it. There's a lot and we didn't cover everything. Okay. That's why I just take a couple examples and talk about it. So this example is from example 3, page 15, PDF page 15. Okay. I just print screen and show it to you. Okay. Use split coil, coil 1 upstream of choke, coil 2 downstream of choke. So we heat it, choke, and heat it again and see what happened. Okay. The given information is we use the same number, 3 million standard cubic feet per day, and specific gravity of 0.7, it is flow rate of that has to be 2000. The typo is not originally from me. It's the textbook itself has a typo, okay? That has to be changed to 2000. Line pressure is 370, shutting pressure is 3000 PSIG, outlet required temperature is 120. So previously, we just let the temperature drop to 61, right? And this time we heat from 61 up to 120 again. We want it hot when it comes out from the line heater. We don't just want to heat it and then choke, and when it exit at 61. We don't want that. We want it to exit at 120. Okay. So now I'll show you how much heat do we need. So the coil will be split into two parts. Coil number 1, preheat. Okay. Coil number 2, after the choke. Okay. In the preheat side, we can use working pressure rating has to be 3000. Okay. After the choke, pressure rating is 750. Okay. From table 1, tube size required 2 inch X heavy. We did that calculation already, right? For the maximum pressure rating and the pressure drop too. So that's 2 inch X. Look at this star. Okay. In the textbook, it recommends to use same 2 inch, but we can actually use smaller. But they argue that, okay, this is what they argue. They said for 2 inch X heavy tube are not actually required for the line pressure in the expansion coil, but the type of tube in the small heater are usually kept the same. So by change from small to very small, it doesn't make much of the difference for the cost. That's what they argue for this case. But if you want it to be cheaper, you can use a smaller one. It said it provides more versatile heater which can be used for other applications at little extra initial cost. I don't know about little extra initial cost. I don't know how little it is, maybe 10 cents, cannot be 10 cents. Okay. So in this example, we assume same pipe size before and after. Okay. Flow pressure 2000 for 2000, and after the choke is 750. That is after the choke. Inlet temperature is coming at 71, and we heat it to 125, and the enthalpy difference is 900. That we read from the chart, and we talked about it already. Okay. What about coil number 2? After the choke, the temperature dropped to 61, right? And we want to heat it up to 120, and the enthalpy difference is 750. That's 750. Salim Soas How do we get 750, Salim?
Don't we use the charts for that?
Which chart? Chart 1, chart 2, chart 3. You don't know the name. Okay. The chart that looks like S-shape, right? You remember that? The chart that looks like S-shape and have several of them. That one tells us the enthalpy difference. So,
sir?
Yes?
I have a question on the equivalent length of what? Isn't that also a function of your working pressure? So how is it compared?
We don't have anything about the equivalent length of pipe until the liquid and gas pipeline design several lectures afterward. So, keep your question for a while. We will talk more about that. For the equivalent length of pipe, right now we just get it from the table. Equivalent length of pipe is a function of how small the pipe is, the diameter of the pipe, and how long the pipe is. Can be a function of pressure. It can be depending on how you calculate the pressure drop. We'll talk more about that in next month program when I say later. Okay, 750. Do you believe that? Let's check a little bit. You want to check 61 to 120 on 750? Okay. So on 750, if we are at 61 Fahrenheit, so that temperature, right, that is the temperature, and we want to heat it back to 120, then the difference between that point and that point is 3950 minus 3200. So the enthalpy difference is 750. So we heat from that point up to that point. Good? Is it clear enough? Question, yes.
So, how do you get 125? Do you go right once you get the 61 degrees?
125 is, who else have this question too? Okay, 175 is from last week. We talked about 175 and the explanation is that we know when we heat, the line will go up, right? When we choke, it moves to the left. So what we try to do is we try to go up and move to the left such that the final point still on the dashed line. Okay? If we start from the dashed line, right? Hydrate formation temperature, we know that if we stop at 175, whenever we turn left, the final point will stay on the dashed line. So we move from one hydrate formation temperature to another hydrate formation temperature after the choke, and that gives us the minimum heat required to just about to form hydrate. We may or may not have hydrate, so that is the minimum heat requirement. Is that clear enough? We go up and turn left and select the point where we stop. We stop where? If we turn left, it still be at the dashed line. And come to see me, please, after the lecture if you have time, okay, if this is not clear enough. So we heat from 3200 up to 3950, that is enthalpy difference. And that is the line 120, so that is the line. And we use specific gravity of 0.7. In the test, I may just ask you for 4.6. And if you cannot do it, then you don't understand it, right? So we need enthalpy difference of 750. Okay, that's an enthalpy difference. Then, from figure 2, given the data of 3 million standard cubic feet per day, so after the choke, it is still 3 million standard cubic feet per day. Martin, oh, let's change, not Martin. Marcos, Pharaoh. Hello, Marcos. Where's the sign-up sheet? Everyone sign up sheet? That's it. Can you please give it to me?
He's not here today.
Oh, what happened to him?
The on field trip.
Oh, the hockey guy or something?
No, for the SPE.
Oh, SPE. Yeah, okay. My class will be university. Jaden in law. Hi, Jaden. How do I get 240?
From the calculation, like you said, the 300,000 using the chart.
Calculation or use the chart or any of that?
Chart.
Yeah. Okay, we can use the chart too. So before the shock, the flow rate is 3 million standard cubic foot per day. After the shock, gas expands, right? Why do we still have 3 million standard cubic foot per day, Jaden? It expands.
Still the same flow.
Why?
Where would it go?
Because of this letter, the letter S, okay? Because we do the measurement at the standard condition. Before the shock, it is that much, and after the shock, the volumetric flow rate actually changed, right? Because it's expanded, it's kind of flow faster, but the volumetric flow rate at the standard condition is the same, okay? And 240, you can use PV equal to NRT, find the volume for the 1 bar mole, and 1 bar mole is about 380 or something, and divided 3 million by 380, and then that's what you get. Or you can use the chart, any of that, and you get 240. All right. From figure 3, you remember the chart to get your value, one of them you get 94. If you use coil number 2, it's also 90? No, not 92, 94. Coil number 2 is also 94. Same number, because it's the same pipe size, right? So, next, log mean temperature difference. You can use the formula, use the chart, one of them, before the shock, you get 80, another one you get 85. Right? Coil area, we get about 40 before the shock. After the shock, we get just about 30. What do? We add the heat duty together. Okay? Heat duty is 300,000 plus 240,000. Add together, become 540. And we add the coil area together. Okay? That coil and that coil. It's become about 70. And can must be taken to select the heat, the total number of tubes can split in even number only or something. You read it for yourself, but you don't need to be that careful. Select the, that's an example of selecting T sub M. But after we do everything, we add that together, right? 540,000 and 70 square feet. So the solution is 3 feet by 10 feet. Let's go back to this. Where is the solution? It's not in here. Okay, we need a rating of 750, right? Do we? The heat rating in BTU per hour, after we add those numbers together, is 540. It is 540. 540 is more than 500, right? That is not going to be enough because we need 540. So we have to go one size up. So that is one size up. And we know that we use just 2-inch X, right? And the coil area, we get about 70. It is less than 85. So it is okay, right? Then we select that model to buy, okay? Split tube, that is the ratio of the split, and it's split the area between 48 and 36. Let's check if it's matched with what we have. The area, we get 40 less than 48, right? And that 30 is less than 36. So the coil area after the split match with what we need. So it's done, we select the right one. Get 10 points in the exam. Maybe it should be more than 10 points. So now you know how to size the split coil, right? That's just a line heater. Basically, you want to be able to tell how much is the fire tube rating that you need and what is the pipe size, okay? In all this calculation, we did not do the erosional velocity calculation yet, okay? For the pipe size, typically, I told earlier, right, the pressure drop is not much of a concern, but you calculate it anyway because most of the time 1 inch is too small, okay? What will be your concern is erosional velocity, and the way to calculate it, it is that equation, C over square root rho, okay? Erosional velocity consideration, maximum velocity limit, we have to consider erosion, noise, and water hammer. Water hammer is the phenomena of transient phenomena when we close the valve or pump stop to work and water just hit the pipe and make it bend or deform or something. Okay, and we don't talk about water hammer in this calculation or anything. So we consider erosion and that should be it. Minimum velocity limitation. The flow velocity should not be too slow. Okay, it should be fast enough to carry any condensate that we have. And we will talk about that more in the pipeline design. Okay. All right, erosional velocity. High velocity can erode the pipe wall with sand or solid. It can be at lower velocity, but it can be estimated with some equation. So erosional velocity is about 60 to 70 feet per second. Okay, 60 to 70. So if you check your velocity and it's more than 60, it could be bad. Okay, it could be bad. Quite likely to be something bad happen. V sub E is the erosion velocity in feet per sec. C is the constant that you are assigned to read and summarize 300 words of the paper. That first of all, you need to know where that paper is. Okay. And rho density. Let's take a look at the homework for a while. You are asked to do the summary of the paper. The location of the paper, you go to course homepage, section 1, click that, reading, click that, erosion, click on that, and that thing that is inside, download it, read it, and do the summary for 200 this time I just gave you 200.